Hey internet, we are coming to you from Las Vegas at CES 2023 with all the news you need to know about the big three, NVIDIA, Intel, and AMD. Hey, Gordon with PC World here. I'm here with Keith May.
Hey internet.
And we got all the news that you need to know about Intel, NVIDIA, and AMD right here. Although we are recording this before the official announcement, so there might be one more thing we don't catch, but we think we got a lot of it. There's a lot to listen to, but we're gonna just boil it down to the things that really matter, right? And we're gonna go, and we wanna be fair, because I know everybody's like, why'd you go first? Well, we're gonna go in the chronological order that the embargo's lifted. That kicks off with Intel, 6 a.m. Yesterday, they announced basically their long-awaited 65-watt desktop parts. Those are basically Raptor Lake chips that are going into existing desktop boards, 65 watts, so considerably lower TDP than the unlocked parts. Basically CPUs for most regular people who don't need all the overclocking and all that stuff. But to me, the real excitement is the mobile lineup. So we already saw 13th gen come out on desktop a while ago. We're now seeing it in laptop. And the short and sweet answer is not a lot of changes, mostly clock bumps. Very similar in a lot of ways in core counts, in TDP. The main difference is you're going to get a few more 100 megahertz. I will say Intel, although I haven't seen any actual data yet, Intel has said power should be a little bit better on 13th gen over 12th gen. So I know you're going, oh, it sounds kind of meh. But I will say the thing that really should kind of knock your socks off is Intel's 13th gen HX announcement, right? Because we got Core i9-13980HX that basically sits on top of the previous Core i9 12th gen part. And you go from a previous 8 performance core and 8 efficiency cores to now an incredible, astounding 8 performance cores and 16 efficiency cores. That basically means 24 cores in a laptop. So yeah, that is a significant increase in core count. This chip, according to Intel's own numbers, we'll show you a chart. It does wallop the previous 12th gen pretty easily. No surprise, because that's 16 cores versus 24 cores. The other thing though is they're also going to give you, because one of the nice things we got on desktop 13th gen was a very nice increase in clock frequency. So now for the Core i9-13980HX, you are getting up to 5.6 gigahertz. And that is a pretty big bump, because let's look at the old one. The previous Core i9-12950HX was 5 gigahertz turbo. So that's a 600 megahertz clock increase. That's going to add up in a lot of lightly threaded applications. These chips, the actual max turbo power is about the same, 157 watts, but this 13980 should pretty much crush everything out there. That means crush M1 Max, crush existing AMD, crush everybody, crush 12th gen, because you're talking a lot of cores in laptops that are very light. And of course, you're going to be seeing a lot of these laptops at the show. In fact, I just saw one earlier, pretty cool water-cooled CyberPower. Check it out. But there is more to come for graphics side, because the right after Intel dropped its news with the 13th gen laptop and desktop chips, NVIDIA.
Yeah, they dropped the same. They started off with desktop. Of course, we've got the new GeForce RTX 4070 Ti that's come out. And at this point, you can go over to PCWorld.com and check out Brad's review and see what he had to say about that. The RTX 4070 Ti is a 12 gigabyte graphics card competing with the previous generation RTX 3090, but at $799 starting MSRP. Where they come on the market, it's gonna be up to the vendors. But the real kicker for the NVIDIA announcement is, just like we've been talking about, is back to the mobile space. Yeah. NVIDIA announced the RTX 40 series mobile parts, and we're talking like the whole lineup of mobile parts. They didn't just say, hey, we've got this new one coming out. They went from the 6 gigabyte RTX 4050 all the way up to the 16 gigabyte RTX 4090. And performance over last generation, of course, there's gonna be an uplift there. But one of the big key factors here is, we brought it up with the Intel, is better power efficiency. And when you start to pair those things together, you're gonna be able to get bigger boost clocks. You're just gonna get more performance for it. And it ranges, most of these parts range all the way down to 60 watts, all the way up to 150 watts for that 4090 mobile. Yeah. But another big thing is, in the mobile scene, this is gonna support the new frame generation. So DLSS3 with frame generation. So that's going to be big in that scene. And of course, they have a new update coming for DLSS 3.0 with frame generation. It's going to take care of a lot of those issues that people have pointed out with ghosting artifacts, with the when it's interpolating those frames and generating the ones in between. So it'll be interesting to see how that translates into the mobile scene, and that'll even lower power consumption as well. So
yeah, and I will say that's the one thing NVIDIA alluded to a lot in its presentation the other day is power efficiency on this new part should be pretty good. They said they mentioned some new feature called tri-memory. Basically, they are able to clock, it sounds to me like they are able to clock the GDDR6 on the 4090, for example. It is not GDDR6X, too much power if it were 6X probably, but they are using tri-memory to basically let the GPU clock the memory to different clock speeds, depending on what's going on. If it's idle, maybe run the memory at lower clocks, because the memory, I'm guessing, is going to be sucking up a lot of battery power. And it looks like with 40 series, we should be see a very decent improvement in battery life.
Yeah. And I mean, look at 16 gigs on a mobile part. That's a lot of memory modules to have to give juice to.
It's really hard because you want to see what the reviews of the 40 series are on gaming and content creation. But you can imagine if you've seen content creation boosts on desktop, 40 series, you can imagine that basically comes over now to laptop.
Oh yeah, and pair that with a 24-core CPU in a laptop?
Yeah, no, it just kind of makes you excited for, you know, Lovelace-based laptop with a high core count CPU from Intel. You're talking 24 core. These things are really going to sing like a laptop 5 years ago wished it could, but it's amazing the power you're going to get in this generation of laptops.
Is it going to be more expensive, though?
Well, they said the 4050 class of GPU in a laptop should start around $999, which is about where the previous generation did. So it doesn't sound like we're going to see much pricing difference, which is a nice change these days.
It sounds like it to me. And, you know, obviously, we'll have to wait and see when we get official price lists from everybody. But it doesn't look like you're going to see that price increase like we saw on desktop components standalone, because they are baked into the laptop cost. So it feels like it will hopefully be more contained, but we'll know as we see more laptops at CES. So it's something we're very interested in finding out about. Of course, I'm looking around to make sure nobody knows our secrets, because the other thing I'm super excited to talk about is the big news coming from AMD, which obviously is its mobile Ryzen 7000 parts. So basically, AMD is announcing maybe five different CPUs in the 7000 series, but this is where you're gonna get a little bit of a headache. The Ryzen, I'm gonna start at the bottom, less excitement at the bottom. Ryzen 7020 series uses Zen 2 cores, and you're gonna max out at four cores. The Ryzen 7030 series, remember, these are 7000, but not exactly the newest thing. Those will be using the Zen 3 cores with up to eight cores. Of course, that's 7 nanometer with Vega DDR4 and LPDDR4. The Ryzen 7035 for thin and light is Zen 3 Plus. That's gonna max out at eight cores as well. That's 6 nanometer based, gives you DDR5, LPDDR5. And the Ryzen 7040 series is actually going to max out at 8 cores, 16 threads, using the Zen 4 cores, TSMC 4N, 4 nanometer process. There's going to be more information there, but at the very top end is the Ryzen 7045 series. So that, of course, is the long-rumored Dragon Range-based Ryzen CPUs. This is Zen 4 based, and it basically is AMD, as the old cliche goes, is AMD taking a page out of Intel's book. Intel basically took desktop chips, put them in laptops, yay, win, and for performance. They're doing that with the 7045. So these Ryzen 7045 chips will max out at 16 cores and 32 threads, 5 nanometer process. So I will say, earlier we talked about Intel. We're going to see what happens, because I don't know who's going to win this battle, because honestly, between Zen 4, 16 cores, and Raptor Lake,
yeah.
You got more cores, but also
more complexity.
More, it's also a little bit hotter. You know, generally in desktop, it's been a little more. So this is going to be, it's going to come down to OEM design for the laptop. It's going to come down to the CPU. So that is going to be, we were not going to know the answer to that till later. But there is more. Hey, so we had to move for OPSEC, but there are some cool stuff here. And the first one is something AMD is calling Ryzen AI. And they're saying it's the world's first integrated AI engine on an x86 processor. That's a lot of very lawyerly thing, I guess. What it means, though, is the Ryzen chips, only the 8 cores, not the 16 core, and only a certain segment of those Ryzen 8 core CPUs will have a dedicated AI engine that will actually support up to 4 concurrent dedicated AI streams for real-time multitasking. What that means, I don't know, but this is the thing the internet will catch, is that the Ryzen AI will be 50% more efficient than Apple M2 Neural Engine. I'm going to say that again. The Ryzen AI, AMD claims, will be up to 50% more efficient than Apple's M2 Neural Engine. And of course, you're going, well, why not use the M1 Max? Well, AMD says, well, the reason is the M2 is actually faster than the M1 Max in AI performance, and chips with the Ryzen AI will be 50% more efficient than those. So that's basically efficiency. So AI, of course, is interesting and all that, but you want to know about desktops, right? You want to know about the desktops.
We've talked a lot about mobile parts at this point. Let's talk about something big.
Yeah, let's talk about the big thing, and this is the big thing. This is the thing that people have been waiting for, and that is finally the Ryzen 7000 series with X3D. At the top end, we have the Ryzen 9 7950 X3D, 16 cores, 5.7 turbo with 120 watt TDP. Next step down is the 12 core Ryzen 9 7900 X3D. 12 cores again, 5.6 boost, 128 watts of TDP. And Ryzen 7 7800 X3D is an 8 core part, up to 5 gigahertz with 120 watt TDP. Interesting to me, though, is the TDP on that 7950X3D, right? Because 120 watts is definitely lower. What is it? 180, 170?
170.
170 watts on the 7950 16-core part. This one actually has a lower TDP, but somehow manages up to 5.7 gigahertz.
I mean, it's even TDP-wise the same as the 7800, the 8-core, so that's... That's like a, gotta be a super bin chip.
Yeah, I mean, and the thing is, nothing should sing too, right? I do wonder, and again, you know, CES is still ongoing. We have more questions than we have answers for. I wanna know exactly how did you get to a lower TDP with seemingly the same boost on some of these chips. But, you know, the big thing though is that cache. Remember, just like the 5800 X3D, you get the cool cache on top. And you get a lot more performance. So looking at the Ryzen 9 7950X3D, they are saying against a 13900K in Rainbow Six Siege, 13% improvement for the 7950X3D, Total War Three Kingdoms, 18%, Red Dead Redemption 2, 23%, Horizon Zero Dawn, 24% improvement in performance. So pretty nice.
Yeah, that's big.
I mean, especially because 13900K sort of had that, you know, little bit of a clock advantage. Looks like that's gone with this X3D part. One disappointing thing I don't have at the moment, let's hope we have it tonight, is how much. That's going to be make or break, right, with any product. But 7950s are, what are they going for now? They're under 600 now? They've got pretty reasonable.
Yeah, 550-ish. Pricing's changing a bit.
It's 550-ish, so it feels like all the prices of the AMD Ryzen 7000s without V-cache have dropped. So you kind of think maybe there's a little bit of room to come in at the same previous price. I don't know if that's possible or not.
That's not a whole lot different than what they did with the last X3D, so...
It's possible, but we'll have to see, wait and see. But, you know, clearly the fact that you're getting all that cash, which definitely benefits gaming, is a big thing. And, you know, AMD did officially say, like, look, if you mostly want gaming, you're going to do the 7800X3D part because that's 8 cores, gives you your large cash. But you know, maybe you do content creation and you want that cache for gaming as well. So you're going to get that now with the 7950X 3D, which people have been demanding for a long time. So big deal here. It's early on CES. I have more questions than I have answers, but clearly AMD is not going down without a fight. We don't know who's going to win this year, but this is pretty spectacular.
Well, and you've dealt with it doing the reviews on these the initial 7000 series parts. How many people in the comments were wait for the X3D? We're waiting for the X3D. We had to wait a long time for X3D in the past. This is like right around the corner. It's like they came out with the initial ones and boom, X3D's on there. You know, but that's like your super high premium stuff. What if that's not quite what you're looking for?
Well, fortunately, the Intel introduced its 65 watts. AMD is introducing its 65 watts. Oh, how do you like that? It's almost like Keith knew. So we get basically three chips, Ryzen 9 7900. We do have prices for this, $429, pretty reasonable, 12 cores. Ryzen 7 7700, 329, 8 cores. And Ryzen 5 7600, 6 cores, 229.
Those are in my opinion, those are very reasonable prices, especially for a 12-core.
Does that take the sting out of it? Because a lot of people were kind of hangry about the original pricing launch of the 7000. You think that's going to do it?
If the performance is there, because I don't know how much like tweakability there are with these parts, but if the performance is there, I think it's going to take a lot of that edge off of it. And now you've got somebody who wants like that absolute most performance. Then you got the person that wants the good performance, but they want the platform. And then you got the people that's like, hey, I want in on the platform, but I don't really want to spend $700 on this. I'd be okay with a cooler running, little slower 12 core.
That
price is very reasonable. I even looked at that and thought, maybe it's time.
Oh, you know, actually, I will say this is probably the most important thing here for people who want that Wraith cooler. You want your Wraith cooler, you're getting your Wraith cooler. Basically, the Ryzen 9 7900 and the Ryzen 7 7700 will come with the Wraith Prism with LED, the most important part.
Hey, that's what they shipped with the 3900X back in the day. It's nice to see it come back.
It is nice to see it come back. And then they kind of missed it. And if you're going to go for the cheap seats, yes, I'm talking to you, Elena, Ryzen 5 7600, you're going to get the Wraith Stealth, which is a nice way of saying No LED stealth. Okay, so, you know, again, please like and subscribe, mash that bell somewhere on the screen, and keep coming back because we are just getting started. CES hasn't even started yet, and we're already tired. I'm losing my voice, and there's gonna be so much news, so many new laptops, so many more questions we have to answer.